So, if you were just joining us, two young men apparently dressed in long black trench coats opened fire about an hour and a half ago.
This morning, the Sandy Hook Elementary School was full of kids concerned about Christmas. And then at 9:40 a.m., shots rang out.
Just minutes after firing two fatal shots at the Virginia Tech dormitory on Monday, Cho Sung-wee returned to his own dorm room and made the final preparations to mail what appears to be a video confession.
You know, earlier this year, I answered a question in an interview by saying, the United States of America is the one advanced nation on earth in which we do not have sufficient common sense gun safety laws, even in the face of repeated mass killings. And later that day, there was a mass shooting at a movie theater in Lafayette, Louisiana. That day.
The four.
So, as we set out this year to defeat the divisive forces that would take freedom away, I want to say those fighting words for everyone within the sound of my voice to hear and to heed. And especially for you, Mr. Gore. From my cold, dead hands.
I grew up in Ireland, a country without guns. I now live in Sweden, a country where the police have guns, but few enough others do. It's next door to a country called Norway, where there are a lot of guns that are kept safely, but one man still managed to murder 69 people, mostly kids, with the ones that he had. Despite growing up with the John Wayne westerns, with Die Hard and The Terminator, I hold pretty much the standard European opinions about guns, that they're dangerous and should be kept out of the hands of those who don't know how to use them. That, in effect, means pretty much every private citizen. My opinions are very much formed by the world that surrounds me. America, however, is a different world. There, in many states, you can walk around with a concealed weapon on your person. You can buy a gun over the counter or at a gun show. In some stores, you can get milk, bread, and ammunition in aisles not too far from one another. Needless to say, a lot of American people like guns, and they can't all be criminals or lunatics. Just as I have opinions that are formed by the environment and culture that I inhabit, so do they. So on a recent trip to Nevada, I went to a firing range with Angus to find out what it was like to wield an implement capable of ending the life of another person in an instant, and why he believed that he has a right to carry one of these implements on his person.
Alright, so I have all revolvers. There's two basic kinds of handguns, semi-automatics and revolvers. Okay. Those all over against the wall are all semi-automatics, which means semi-automatic means one trigger pull, one bullet. They have cartridges that slide up and down. These are all revolvers, which means they have a canister that revolves around. Right. This one and this one are 357 Magnums. This one is a 38 Special. Right. What that means is the length of the bullet, the number of a bullet, 44, 22, 38, is the width of the bullet. The length, a Magnum is an extra long bullet. So if you're you'll be able to see the difference. That's a 38, and that's a 357. You see the 357 is longer.
Really?
All right. A 357, because 357 and 38 are such a close size, a 357 gun can fire either one. All right. So we do most of our practice with the smaller rounds. They're easier on the hands. The bigger rounds won't fit in just the 38. Okay. It sticks out. Right? So this one can only take the 38 rounds. This one will take either one. Right? 44, you can imagine, is a much thicker, bigger bullet. 22 is a much smaller bullet. 9mm, which is a standard, most of the semi-automatics are 9mm, almost the same size as the 38. So there you go. Once you're on the range, keep your earmuffs and your eyes on at all times. In the beginning, I'll load the guns for you. Right? The barrel of the gun always points down the range, right? Never anywhere else. and your finger stays outside the trigger guard all the time until you're set and ready to fire. Okay. Once you fire, stay calm, keep looking down the range. You always want to be aware of what's on the range and what's past it. When you're done, just put them down, I'll show you how to unload them. Okay. When you're trying, don't try to count. Each of these fires six, this one only fires five, but don't try to count. Keep firing and fire until it doesn't fire anymore. That way you know there's not a live round in the chamber. Any questions? Cool, let's go. The most embarrassing thing is if it jumps and pops out of your hand.
Okay.
So you have a nice, solid grasp. Line that up with what you're shooting at.
Okay.
Keep your elbows a little bit bent, so don't lock them out, okay, or else that'll hurt. Okay. Keep your hands nice and loose.
Angus McIntosh is a self-defense instructor who lives in Las Vegas, Nevada, where he teaches Aikido and facilitates courses for the National Rifle Association. Originally, when I spoke to him, I thought I'd do some snazzy editing with some emotive clips and on-point music, like at the start of this piece. I've changed my mind. Though our opinions may be poles apart, he is an intelligent, articulate man who should be allowed to speak for himself. So what you're about to hear is the unedited recording of our conversation in the car as we left the range. I started by asking him about the reaction of others that he had brought to the firing range to fire a gun for the first time.
They cry.
Do they, huh?
You know, I've had that happen. It happened the first time I took my wife, taking a couple other people, even a couple of men who, first time, it's like, whoa. You know, it's such a rush. There's so much power to it.
Mm-hmm.
You can see why it becomes very addictive, too.
But is that the case? Like, you know, because if you say to people in Europe, you know, all guns, and they go, you know, well, it's too dangerous and this kind of thing, what's the big attraction? Is it the power? Is it the...
I think so. I think it is the power.
Mm-hmm.
It's also... I mean, I could go on for a very long time on this. It's a cheat.
How do you mean?
It takes... I've trained in the martial arts for 30 years. Okay? And it takes... years and years of hard work to get to the point where you feel like you're safe most of the time. Mm-hmm. Or it takes $300 and 2 days at the range. And you kind of have the same thing. It's not really true because I teach, I work sometimes with the National Rifle Association and teach classes with how to get to your gun. I mean, people buy firearms or sidearms, and they have no real clue how to use it. They go to the range three or four times. They go get a concealed carry permit, which allows them to carry anywhere they'd like to. And then that's it. They don't keep going to the range. They don't keep training. They don't practice over and over and over again. And the biggest problem with firearms in terms of that I see is that people don't take it seriously enough. It's just so easy to go to Walmart or someplace and pick up a handgun and then put it in your pocket or in your purse or next to your bed and just leave it there. When most, for example, most law enforcement, they have to train and test, like in federal law enforcement, they have to test twice a year. Right? So they have to go to the range. They have to keep practicing. They have to keep going. And most people don't do that. And that, I think, is where the real danger comes in. You know, people say, oh, you need to keep people from buying guns. No, you need to keep people who... own guns, trained and able to use them.
But is that the problem then, that the training isn't mandatory and that basically anybody can get their hands on a gun regardless of if they're in control of the weapon or not?
I think the biggest problem is inconsistency from place to place. I don't want to give you a giant history lesson, but up until the Civil War, anyone could carry any gun in the United States. After the Civil War in the South, African Americans started carrying guns, and that was not acceptable to the most populace. And what happened is that gun legislation is now based on a county by county basis, not even state by state for the most part. The sheriff of the county decides who can carry a gun. And so you have hundreds, I have no idea, a couple hundreds and hundreds of counties throughout the country, and they're all different. I lived in California for 24 years and could not carry a gun because the county that I lived in, San Francisco County, had issued 2 carry permits in 50 years. Now, I moved to Las Vegas and a Saturday class and you can get your carry permit. Well, if you move to Arizona, it's a shorter class that you can get your permit. And if you move to New York City, you can't get one at all, right? So there's no way to control something when it's at the whim of local states. All the states break down into one of two kinds. You either what's called a shall issue state and a may issue state. In a shall issue state, the sheriff has to issue it, but he can set whatever kind of qualifications for it. In a may issue state, then it's county by county. Like in San Francisco County, you cannot get one. But in some of the northern counties of California, it's one of some of the easiest places in the country to get one. So that complete lack of consistency makes it very, very difficult to regulate.
Have you ever had to use a firearm for your own protection or the protection of others?
No.
Okay. Is it something that you expect to do in your lifetime?
No. Although that may be somewhat unique to me because I would choose not to. I've trained for 30 years in Aikido, and the point of the training is to be the least, to do the least harm possible to someone.
And yet at the same time, when you leave the house in the morning, you have a gun, right?
Almost always, yes. Let me put it this way. A friend of mine explained it to me this way. Every time you leave the house, you feel just a tiny bit stupid. You put the gun in the back or wherever you carry it, and you feel just a tiny bit stupid. But that, all of those tiny bit stupid is so much better than the one really stupid time. My wife didn't used to approve that I carry. And one day we had spent a few days in Arizona and we were driving back. I had a car at that time and the front tire blew. It's about 2 in the morning. We blew the tire. We're off on the side of the road in the middle of the desert. Nobody's around. We had to wait until someone came with a jack. And so we had to sit in the side of the road in the middle of the desert at 2 in the morning for about an hour and a half until the truck got there. And 3 or 4 times, you know, vans or trucks kind of slow down and loop around. And my wife looks over at me and she nudges me and she says, "Are you carrying tonight?" And I said, "Yes, I have." "Okay, I get it now." So for that one time, I was very glad I had it.
But I'm just thinking the amount of people who die by firearms, you know, firearms that aren't properly stored in the home and that kind of thing. Is it worth it if you balance up that one time that you felt the extra protection of the firearm against all these deaths? How does that balance out?
That's a very, very kind of tricky question. Because at your core, you're asking which is more important, safety or individual liberty. And if you're going to choose safety, then we shouldn't have cars. We shouldn't have all sorts, McDonald's, for example. There are all sorts, cigarettes, alcohol. If you're going to choose safety over personal liberty, that's a very slippery slope as to who decides where that line gets drawn. For me, I would always choose personal liberty. And we send, especially as an American, we send our young men off to places supposedly in pursuit of liberty, a liberty that we're not always willing to practice at home.
I wonder, does that sort of extend all the way back to the Civil War and the point of the Civil War, which was to, or not the, sorry, not the Civil War, the War of Independence, that it was to guarantee this individual liberty? Freedom seems to be the beginning and the end of this issue for people like yourself who believe in the right to carry firearms.
I agree, and in fact, in some readings of American history, the Tea Party, the original battles at Concord were partially over whether the British could barracks the guns.
So this is not a new issue.
So it's not a new issue. It's that old, and it will probably be continue to be fought for the next couple hundred years.
What would happen if the governor of Clark County or the sheriff of Clark County said, "You got to hand in your guns, Angus"? What would happen?
I think most people would just ignore him. I lived in San Francisco where you're not supposed to have a gun and you're not half, most people don't have guns, although I knew literally hundreds of people who all had guns. That's gets to a core of the problem is in the argument here, people will say, let's make guns illegal. That's fine. There's 300 million Americans and about 400 million guns out there. Making them illegal will not magically make them go away. What are you going to do to round up 400 million guns, many from people who won't give them to you? I would not want the job of knocking on doors saying, give me your gun. And the job would be so overwhelming to try to round up that many sidearms from that many people. I'm not even sure it's practically possible at this point. This maybe is a conversation you could have had 100 years ago.
But if you can't put the genie back in the bottle, what can you do? Because there is an issue here. There are people dying probably needlessly every day because of the fact that people who have firearms and who don't know how to use them are in possession of them. What can you do to make the whole thing safer and still let people have this liberty?
I'm not sure there is anything you could do. I mean, all liberties come with a certain cost. And, you know, if someone is going to buy a very powerful handgun, say a Glock that holds 18 or 19 rounds, and then leave it on their kitchen table while their three-year-old plays next to it, I'm not sure there's anything in the world you can do with that, as you also could not stop them from sending the kid out with a lawnmower either.
I'm just thinking, though, that there are regulations here about having a swimming pool in your home. And I know there are regulations for guns as well in different counties and different states and that kind of thing.
Oh, there are some regulations in every county and every state.
But how do we get to grips with the fact that, you know, can you legislate for people's own stupidity?
No. No, I don't think so. I'm not sure you can legislate. I mean, yes, you have, I don't even know. I think there are 8 or 10 specific rules about pools just here in Clark County in Las Vegas. And there are at least a dozen kids who drown every single year. I'm not sure all of those regulations has changed the bottom line number very much.
Where do you see this going? If you see a Democratic president coming in and, you know, he or she continues the same rhetoric against guns, which there has been for the last couple of years, where do you see this going politically for America as a whole and not just Clark County?
I think it's always going to be contentious, and I think it's always going to be a county-by-county issue. I don't think they're ever going to address that. So when you start to talk about big federal regulations, most of those only cover what some states do now. A little bit of a longer waiting period or a little bit of a registration. I don't think there's ever going to be much more to that. I don't think there's a political view. You're not going to be able to go into the Deep South or the West and get any kind of bigger legislation passed.
So you don't see a situation where the federal government could say all firearms must be licensed?
No, I don't think so. Again, it would be a gargantuan task to even attempt to do that. And I think, you know, you would see tremendous states' rights rebellions, because that's always a conflict because of the kind of unique and absurd way we set up our system, that what is a state's right and what is a federal right is at the core of much legislation. And I'm not sure that would ever be settled around this particular issue.
And that's a fear for a lot of people, that the federal government is going to come and tell each people in each state what to do. And it's kind of unique, in the way that America is set up. Is there any way that the states themselves might agree to something like that?
Some states, Illinois, California, New York, Massachusetts, would certainly agree to that. Wyoming, Nevada, Tennessee, Alabama, Arkansas, those states would never agree to it. It would be political suicide in that state for anyone to agree to that. It just wouldn't happen.
You have a concealed carry permit now. How long have you had it?
2 years since I moved to Las Vegas.
And do you ever see a time when you won't go out of the house without your gun?
Oh, there are times now. It depends on where I'm going. For instance, a few months ago, we went to Dave Rooney's birthday party at his house. And I did not carry, because he has children in his house, and that would be rude.
It would be rude rather than unsafe.
Yeah, I would consider that rude, too. Yeah, he doesn't necessarily approve, and I'm going into his house. I would never carry into, say, his house with where he has his children.
Are there any other circumstances under which?
Even with a concealed carry permit, there are lots of places you can't go.
Such as?
Any federal building, any state building, any court, Department of Motor Vehicles, anything like that, you can't go. You can't carry. So any place like that, I would not carry.
Would you like to see that opened up? Because we've seen situations where universities, it's been insisted by the state that because it's legal, because concealed carry is legal, well, then it has to be legal on campus. Is that something you'd like to see as well?
I would like to see that. I spent many years teaching self-defense courses to girls who were getting out of high school and going off to university. And if you're 18 or 21, depending on what the law is in your state, and you have met the requirements and you have your concealed carry, it seems random at best to keep it off campus. And campus is statistically where you're most likely to need it.
What about the people who feel unsafe when other people have guns?
I've ridden a motorcycle for years. I feel unsafe with everyone in a car. There's not much I can do about that.
So it's a case of one liberty or one individual doesn't trump another, so to speak.
I doubt that everyone's going to stop driving cars or even stop texting while they're driving their car to protect me on my motorcycle. Every weekend during the summer, there are bike lists, and every weekend, most of the list is so-and-so rest in peace or pray for someone else because somebody wasn't paying attention and ran them over. More bikers die every year on the roads than most other statistical groups for their age, and no one is particularly concerned about their fear or particularly concerned about that. You're kind of cherry picking. Should we be very concerned about this? Well, something else is actually much worse.
I'm just thinking, would you be in favor of legislating against particular types of guns? And I'm thinking in particular the sort of big semi-automatic weapons.
The problem is that if you understand the weapons, that's not particularly important. The standard semi-automatic, like a Glock that takes 19, or they have these large banana clips that will take 30 or 35 rounds. Anyone who understands duct tape can make one of those by buying two perfectly legal ones and duct taping the bottom and then flipping it. So, yeah, in California, for example, they just had the shooting in San Bernardino. Those were all perfectly legal clips. And that's part of the problem with legislation is, yes, there have been a tremendous amount of shootings within the last 20 years. There has not been a shooting that would have been prevented with any of the laws that have been suggested. Okay? So those people would have still had their guns. Most of them would have had them legally or could have gotten them legally. It wouldn't change the outcome at all.
Assault rifles, that kind of thing. Is there really a need to have that in one's home?
No, but they are really fun. They are. I mean, I don't own one at the moment. I have in the past. I do have a shotgun. They're just a whole lot of fun. And then you take them out and they make a lot of noise and they have a lot of power and they're even more fun than handguns. But no, there's no particular reason. I'm not sure there's a particular... None of us go hunting very much. I've not needed my gun to go get hamburger at Safeway.
But you wouldn't like to see a situation where we said maybe take these out of Walmart because, you know, they're a lot of fun, but still.
I think, and you having shot a .357 today, if I had a choice, I'd probably rather get shot by the little bullet that comes out of an assault rifle or an AK-47 than the .357 you shot a few hours ago.
Yeah, I think I'm going to have to agree with you on that.
So, would you like to be shot with a big bullet that doesn't go as far or a little bullet that goes a little farther?
Can I choose not to be shot at all?
That would be the best choice.
So, am I convinced by Angus? Will I be lobbying for the right to bear arms in Sweden? Frankly, no. But that's not the point. My intention was never to change his mind, or yours, but just to open my own. What I have gained by meeting Angus and by speaking to him at length was not an opportunity to convince him of the evils of guns, but to hear for myself why a reasonable, responsible adult would choose or feel the need to even have a gun. And what I have learned from meeting him is very simple. Though there may be seemingly simplistic solutions to the gun issue in America, it's going to take a long, long time before Americans feel secure enough in themselves to even contemplate doing so. We'll be right back.